Welcome to Mars Studio. We are here shooting another episode at Detroit Drummers Podcast. I am Tawan Butter Hawkins, and I am sitting here with my main man's here, Myron G. Bell.
What's going on, my friend?
What's happening, brother? You all right?
Man, all is well, man.
Man, I'm so excited about having you here in the studio today,
man,
brother.
Man, I appreciate you guys having me, man.
Man,
I've been
yeah.
waiting on this for a minute, so we're finally here.
That's what's up. Yeah. So I want to talk about the track that you played for us, the first track that you played for us.
Okay.
Can you tell us a little bit about it?
Cool, yeah, absolutely. So the very first track is entitled Happy Tuesday. And it's a song from my forthcoming project entitled Versatile. It speaks to versatility of, you know, the gifts that God has equipped me with.
Yeah.
So, and that should be out later on this year. I don't have a date yet. But anyway, like I said, I think that was my second single. And it was written by me. And one of my favorite songs, man, from the project.
So you say written by you. You did the horns and the keyboards and all that too?
Yeah, you know what? So I don't play, uh-huh. you know, but I am one of the most, I guess you can say, musical drummers, you okay. know, praise be to God. But, man, I literally sung that song out in my phone. Uh-huh. The entire song, talking about the hits, you know, the verse, the chorus, everything.
Wow.
And I shout it off to my good friend Marcus Abernathy. Shout out to Marcus Abernathy.
Marcus, he out there.
Yeah. So I shout it off to him, and I said, Marcus, man, I need you to help me out, you know, with the composition of this. Uh-huh. And we sat at his piano at his house, and he played it down exactly how I
wow.
vocalized it in my phone.
Wow.
And we took it to the studio, and the rest was history, man.
It made it happen.
Yeah, it made it happen.
That's what's up, man. That's a good story.
Yeah.
The brother sung it in his phone, y'all.
I did a few songs. I did, man. In fact, I did probably all of my project like that.
Yeah. It helped you remember what's going on
yeah,
in your head at the time so you don't forget it.
Oh, yeah.
I totally get it. So how long have you been playing?
Ooh. As I always say, man, I came out the womb mm-hmm. with a pair of drumsticks, pretty much. Yeah, man, but you know what? I officially started in my grandfather's church, Greater Mount Everest Church of God in Christ. Mm-hmm. Love you guys. But, I officially started in church, I would say, around the age of 7. Mm-hmm. And, you know, I come from a very musically inclined church.
Okay.
So everybody there does something, whether they sing, you know, there's a young lady who wrote Teach Me, O Lord, that was recorded by my aunt Vanessa Bell Armstrong.
Okay.
So, yeah, you know, it was just talent everywhere in there, man. And, you know, I was surrounded by, just talented people, so it was inevitable
right.
that it would kind of just rub off on me.
Right. I see. You just in the musical family, you're just there, absorbing it all, sucking it all in.
It's like
right?
an osmosis, yeah. I was just bringing it all in. Yeah.
Yeah. So you were attracted to the drums. Did you have a drum teacher or an instructor, a mentor, or anything like that?
Well, I had a couple of mentors, but as far as official training or you know the education side of it, no. Mm-hmm. I did well, you know, I attended Mumford High School, mm-hmm. and I was in the band class, the jazz band there.
Okay.
So I was under the tutelage of Dr. Doakes, but I have several mentors, I mean, you know, from,
right,
you
right,
know,
right.
the Dana Davis, yeah. to the Michael Williams, you know, Joe Smith, Joey Bruce,
mm-hmm.
There's a guy by the name of Gino Parker. I think he's from Ipsy or somewhere up there.
Okay.
But yeah, you know. So man, I just always kind of just kept my ear to the street.
Yeah.
You know, and just kind of hung around, man. You know, in different places. You know, I was always at a music corps rehearsal or mm-hmm. something. You know, just kind of just standing back and just taking it all in. Yeah. And you know, so it kind of just happened like that.
Okay. So in terms of your approach to rudiments, tell me about that.
You know what? So. The way that I approach rudiments, I kind of liken it to or kind of compare it to having good clarity of speech.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I'm saying? You know, like, you know, when you speak, you know, naturally you want to come across as articulate,
right.
you know, and right. well heard. I approach it the same way with drumming or with my rudiments, where I want every single note to be heard, to be felt.
Mm-hmm.
You know, so, you know, I'm very adamant about making sure that when I do a drum roll, that, you know, you can hear every little nuance, you know, in between, you know, so that, you know, it's not cluttered or anything like that. So like I said, you know, it's kind of like, you know, having great vocabulary, you know, from
And that's really what I appreciate about your drumming is like you hear every, like you just say, every note. It's just very clear, very precise. And and not only that, it's like you have a lot of control while you're playing.
Yeah, that's important too, you know. I kind of had that drilled into me, man, when I was coming up by, you know, I just spoke up from Dana Davis. Mm-hmm. You know, he was hard on me about things like that, you know, like, yeah, man, you know, you started off good, man, but by the time you got to your floor time here, you know, man, you know, I can't understand what's going on. Uh-huh. So, you know, man, control yourself. That, you know, he was real hard. He still is. So, So it's like, almost like every time I play, I almost hear Dana in the back of my head, like, where is he? Is he good? Okay. You know.
He embraced something that you never forget. It
just absolutely.
Speaks to you every time you sit down.
Oh, yeah. Absolutely. Absolutely.
That's what's up, man. So tell me about your approach to improv, improvisational, like when you... like your solos and stuff like that. Like, how do you construct that?
So that is the equivalent to, or what I would liken that to, is like songwriting. Mm-hmm. You know, so I just try to be free. You know, I try not to, you know, kind of lock myself into one style of solos or anything. You know, because I'll be honest with you, man. Until now, I hated solos. Because, you know, it's a lot of it was always a lot of pressure.
Yeah.
Because, you know, when, you know, and you know, and in the smooth jazz world, you know, a lot of drummers, as we know, you know, when it's solo time, like, a lot of times, all the musicians will leave the stage, mm-hmm. and it's just you.
Yeah.
So you gotta say something.
Right.
You gotta come up with something. So, and then when I was younger, man, you know, I was always drumming or air drumming or, you know, just kind of, you know, sounding off drum sounds, you know, with my da 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 da. You know, I still kind of do it now, you know. So, yeah, you know, so it kind of just, you know, it helps.
That's cool. Do you, how often do you practice?
Ooh, man, I've not practiced. I used to shed all the time, man, when I was younger. But, you know, it's kind of, you know, kind of shame to say it, man. But, yeah.
Kind of living off of muscle memory.
Yeah.
I understand. I totally get it.
But you know what? But what keeps me, what's cool is that what keeps me sharp is that the church that I play at, which is the Second Ebenezer Church, shout out to Pastor, mm-hmm. or Bishop, Edgar Van, Bishop. Yeah, so, you know, playing at a church like that, it's a mega church, and it's a lot of energy every Sunday, so it keeps me sharp.
Yeah.
It keeps me on my game.
Right.
So, you know, although I'm not, you know, I don't really have a lot of, but the only reason why I don't practice too much is because I'm in an apartment building, and, you know, and I can't really, you know, stretch out like I want to. But that's going to soon change.
Yeah.
And once it does, you know, I'll be back on top.
And then if you're playing a lot, then it's kind of takes
when you're playing, And then, you know, like I heard one of my favorite drummers, Teddy Campbell, he said that, you know, he was kind of speaking to the same thing, how a lot of times he does, you know, he doesn't get to practice as much as he likes. But what he'll do is he said part of practicing for him is just simply listening to music, you know, listening to other drummers and listening to their approach. And just kind of incorporating some of what they're doing to your style,
right?
You know, so when you do sit down, you know, you kind of, you know, retain some of that information or some of those things that you, you know, that you you covered,
right?
You know, in your personal listening time or pleasure or whatever, and
Well, that's a form of practicing listening, definitely.
Definitely.
And I think more drummers probably need to listen and maybe put down the sticks and listen to what's going on around them.
I would concur.
So I totally get it.
Yeah,
especially man. Some of the younger guys, you know.
Yeah.
Shout out to the young. We all do.
Oh, yeah.
It's a journey. You know, I remember practicing till, you know, man, 8 to 14 hours a day. And then, you know, it went to like, to nothing, you know, but I would always listen a lot, you know what I'm saying? So
yeah.
I totally get that. Then you got muscle memory after so long, you know.
Exactly, like, you know. And then I'm always learning material because, I mean, you know, the turnover of music there,
right.
You know, is literally from week to week.
Right.
So, you
That's
know,
right.
yeah, like you said, you know, I'm always exercising that muscle, you know, that memory muscle, and Yeah, and it works out for me, man.
So, that's what's up. That's what's up. Yeah. Myron G. Bell, ladies and gentlemen. Hey, we're gonna listen to that. We're gonna play the next song for us, and then we're gonna come back and we're gonna wrap it up.
Absolutely. Sounds good, man.
Myron G. Bell, ladies and gentlemen. We'll be right back. That was a hot tune. Now tell me, what was the name of that tune again?
So the name of that tune was Unmasked, and it was written by Daryl BB. Okay. Saxophonist, my good friend and brother. What's up, Daryl?
Daryl, shout out to Daryl. That's what's up. Now, man, you did some fantastic things on there. Can you tell me about some of the things that you did and what influenced you to play like you played on that tune? Because you did some really incredible things on it.
Thank you. First of all, I appreciate that. Well, it starts with the fact that song is absolutely one of my favorites. I mean, you know, the composition of it is just amazing. I believe it was written by Daryl and our other good friend, Mark Polo Dixon. Shout out to the camp. Yeah. Uh-huh. But yeah, man, it's just, you know, I don't know, something about it, man, it just, you know, it has a lot of melody in it and a lot of, just a good, it's just a, one of those, what I call a good feel-good song.
It's a feel-good song.
It's a feel-good song, and, you know, I get to express myself, you know, in a lot of different ways. So, yeah, you know, and then I love Calypso, you know.
I heard the change up when I was saying, oh, you know, when Latin on this.
I love Latin feels.
Yeah, yeah.
So it's my kind of song, and, you know, I'm upset that I didn't write it.
Right. Yeah. Yeah, well, you played the heck out of it.
Thank you, man. I appreciate it,
That's for sure.
I appreciate it.
So tell us, man, if we wanted to come see you, where are you playing at? Who are you playing for? You know, where can we find Myron G. Bell?
Well, you can find Myron G. Bell every Sunday at Second Ebenezer Church, located in Detroit, Michigan, on DeQuinder and I believe 6 Mile. Mm-hmm. Because we've kind of just got into the new year, you know, some things are still, you know, kind of formulating, coming about. So, mm-hmm. you know, there will be some things, you know, pending this year. So you can follow me on Myron G. Bell at Facebook, on Facebook, Myron G. Bell, and Instagram, Bell Music. And, you know, and you will see what I'm doing around town.
So you post your gigs?
I post I post my gigs.
Yeah, so. I think I bumped up on a video of you playing on, I think it was Baker's.
Oh yeah, man. Yeah, that was crazy. I didn't even know they were recording that. But you know, it
yeah,
was
I think
just...
I think Brother Jarrell, shout out to Jarrell.
Jarrell James.
Yeah.
That's my guy.
But I saw it on, I think it might have been on one of his pages, and I say, Myron at Baker's?
The Reverend? Myron at Baker's? Yeah, man, you know, hey, you know.
And he was kicking, man.
Thanks, man.
I watched the video. I sat there and watched the whole thing.
You know what? Actually, that particular evening, I was filling in for Jarrell.
Okay.
Because he had another situation. I think he does usually 2 sets or something at Baker's mm-hmm. on Sunday nights. Mm-hmm. So the first set, he was committed to something else.
I see.
Yeah, so he needed me to fill in. So I said, man, you know, hey, no problem.
He's now, tell me about that experience. Because how often do you get to play, smooth jazz, R&B? Kind of thing? Is that the vibe there?
Yeah, uh-huh. So actually working with Daryl has really kind of, you know, introduced me to that whole smooth jazz, mm-hmm. you know, world pretty much,
okay.
you know. Yeah, because, you know, I am from the church world, mm-hmm. you know. But, you know, the Lord has blessed me, man, to be able to work with, you know, other smooth jazz artists.
Right.
My good friend, shout out to Demetrius Crayon Neighbors.
Crayon,
yeah, that's my guy. But Crayon, yeah, you know, he looks out for me from time to time, you know, has put me on situations, mm-hmm. you know, that, you know, I count, you know, an extreme blessing. You know, I did a show with Julian Vaughn, mm-hmm. bassist, Lynn Roundtree. And then I have a upcoming situation, I believe, with jazz artist Kim Scott sometime later this year.
Okay.
But yeah. And then I did some stuff with, you know, the man himself, Demetrius. Mm-hmm. So, you know, so like I said, having friends in the smooth jazz realm, it kind of brings
opens
me along.
Up some other stuff.
Always opens me up. Yeah.
That's awesome.
So,
Myron G. Bell, ladies and gentlemen. Look, find him, follow him, go on Instagram, do what you got to do, Facebook. Him, one of the hottest drummers in Detroit, in Michigan.
Oh, thank
probably
you, man.
This Midwestern hemisphere, if you will.
Oh, man,
man, we enjoy having you out here, brother.
Hey, man,
thanks again, brother.
It,
yeah,
man.
Yeah,
God bless you, man.
God
good.
Bless you, brother. Hey, so we are here at Mars Studio. Beautiful studio here. If you need some music or recording or anything of that nature, a rehearsal spot, you definitely want to get over here to Mars Music. You can email Marcus at meondrums@gmail.com. That's meondrumz at gmail.com. All right? Thanks again, brother, for coming out.
Hey,
and
we
look forward to hearing you somewhere around the city.
Oh, yeah.
On
yeah.
somebody's album, somebody's concert.
Oh, yeah. 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 You know, it's going to be a great year.
All
it's
right.
It's going to be a great year.
All right. Yeah. Hey, thanks for joining us. Until next time, God bless. Peace.
Peace.